Yeah.
Yeah.
Sarana Rusha Charayo Pakaya Tamana.
च तत्र किम् अलभ्यम् अनन्त आद्ये
तुष्टे च तत्र किम् अलभ्यम्
अनन्त आद्ये
किं तद्गुणव्यतिकरा इह येष्वसिधा
किं तद्गुणव्यतिकरा इह येष्वसिधा
धर्मादय किम् अगुणेन च काङ्क्षितेन
धर्मादय किम् अगुणेन च काङ्क्षितेन
सारं युषां चरणयोरुपगायतानां
सारं युषां चरणयोरुपगायतानां
तुष्टे च तत्र किम् अलाप्यमनन्त आद्ये
तुष्टे
च तत्र किम् अलाप्यमनन्त आद्ये किं तद्गुणव्यतिकरा इह येष्वसिधा
किं तद्गुणव्यतिकरा इह येष्वसिधा
धर्मादय किम् अगुणेन च काङ्क्षितेन
धर्मादय किम् अगुणेन च काङ्क्षितेन
सारं युषां चरणयोपगायतां नः
The Supreme Personality of Godhead.
The Supreme Personality of Godhead.
The original source of everything, the cause of all causes.
The original source of everything, the cause of all causes.
Kim. What need?
Tai.
Gunagatikara. Due to the actions of the modes of material nature.
Iha.
In this world.
Which.
Shvasidaha.
Automatically achieved.
Dharma adayaha. The three principles. Of material advancement. Namely.
Religion,
economic development,
and sense gratification.
What need? With liberation into the Supreme.
Cha and Kanchitena.
Desire.
Sharam.
Essence.
Relation, of the two lotus feet of the Lord.
Upagayatam, who glorify the qualities of the Lord.
Of us.
Translation purport is like this, I see, Bhaktivedanta Swami, Siddhu, Bhakti, Nothing is unobtainable for the devotees who have satisfied the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is the cause of all causes, the original source of everything. The Lord is the reservoir of unlimited spiritual qualities for devotees. Therefore, who are transcendental to the modes of material nature. What is the use of following the principles of religion, economic development, sense gratification, and liberation, which are all automatically obtainable under the influence of the modes of nature? We devotees always glorify the lotus feet of the Lord. Therefore, we need not ask for anything in terms of dharma, kama, artha, and moksha. Purport. In an advanced civilization, people are eager to be religious, to be economically well situated, to satisfy their senses to the fullest extent and at last to attain liberation. However, they are not to be magnified as desirable. Indeed, for a devotee, these are all very easily available. Bilvamangala Thakur said, Mukti Svayam Mukuritam Javi Sevate Sman Dharmashtakam Kataya Samaya Pratikshaha. Liberation always stands at the door of a devotee, ready to carry out his order. Material advancement in religion, economic development, sense gratification, and liberation simply wait to serve the devotee at the first opportunity. A devotee is already in a transcendental position. He does not need further qualifications to be liberated. As confronted by Gita 14.26, Saguna Samutrayetam Brahma Puyayana Kalpate, a devotee is transcendental to the actions and reactions of the three modes of material nature because he is situated on the Brahman platform. Prahlada Maharaj said, Agunena cha kamshitena, if one is engaged in the transcendental loving service of the lotus feet of the Lord, he does not need anything in terms of dharma, artha, karma, and moksha. In Srimad Bhagavatam, therefore, in the beginning of the transcendental literature, it is said, dharma prajito kaitavatra. Dharma, artha, karma, and moksha are kaitava. False and unnecessary. Nirmatsanam, persons who are completely transcendental to the material activities of separateness, who make no distinction between mine and yours, but who simply engage in the devotional service of the Lord, they are actually fit to accept Bhagavata Dharma, Dharma Bhagavatam Iha. Because they are nirmatsara, they are not jealous of anyone. They want to make others devotees, even their enemies. In this regard, Srila Madhvacharya remarks, Kankshayeta, Kankshate, Mokshadam, Api Sukam, Nakankshato, Yata. Devotees are not desirous of any material happiness, including the happiness derived from liberation. This is called anyabhilasita sunyam jnana kramadi anavritam. Karmis desire material happiness, jnanis desire liberation, but a devotee does not desire anything. He is simply satisfied by rendering transcendental loving service at the lotus feet of the Lord and glorifying Him everywhere by preaching, which is His life and soul. Beautiful purple. Om Ajnana Chandandasya Vindanasma Pya Chakshurvindanam Vindanasma Sita Vindanasma Dichas Pranitana Vindanasma Prabhupada Pranam Naomi Pati Chirupada. Yeah, so we are continuing in this chapter, Prahlada is Sikshi's demonic schoolmates. That's very interesting because today also everybody are demonic schoolmates. So although they were all from families of heavy demonic mentality, absolute interested in controlling everything around them, and after controlling they can enjoy themselves and kick out everybody who's standing in the way. So how you preach to these people? How you can come close to such type of people? Because if you come too close, they bite you. So then you have to talk all this pure philosophy. And Prahlad had, I think he had so much compassion for his friends around him, although they're crazy guys, they're materialists to the highest degree, that he started to talk immediately this very strong knowledge, the illusion of this material world, how everything is an illusion. And that is centered around this worldly family life, because that's the field of Sanskrit education is the unit of family life. So then he totally smashed the idea, the first 10, 20 years finished, the last 10, 20 years finished, when you sleep, 50 years finished, how much years left? 10 years. And in the middle of that life, you're busy protecting everything, my children, my house, my... So everything is gone. So the friends. But why are you doing it? He says. You think all these things are dear to you. But why they are dear to you? Because the body is dear to you. You know, it facilitates all the bodily activities around you, so you become attached, you feel it dear. But what, of course, what is that feeling of dear? It's, I don't know, Krishna, how can something, that matter, become dear to you? I can't understand this. You know, it's dead. How it can become, how you can relate to it with affection? I can't understand how that happens. So it must be something Krishna puts there. So then Prahlad says, it's all because of the body. Huh? And somebody from another country or somebody you never saw, you don't feel dear because you don't have a bodily interaction, you know, on the worldly way, so you cannot feel for them or something. You know, but somebody you live with, then you become dear. It's all because of these bodily experiences. And then again, Prahlad says, why the body is dear? Because it's just work, it's just material energy, earth, water, fire, air. It's because of the soul, the living entity, because when the body is dead, and when as soon as even an old man who is almost gone, but he is still alive, everybody cares. But as soon as he leaves his last breath, suddenly nobody cares anymore. The body is dead and then fast we want to get rid of it. That's an amazing thing. Even for materialists, they are very aware of this. As soon as the light is gone, then the whole attitude changes towards the body. And immediately the plants come out to get rid of it. But while it is there, we are so busy with the bodily comfort. All our energy goes to that, all our consciousness goes to that. The body, the mind is absolutely connected. You know, the mind is a function for the body. And he keeps roaming and trying and thinking and doing. And then as soon as the soul is gone, then no more attachment for the body. So that is intelligence, Prahlad says. You have to go beyond the bodily concept. It's a simple concept, but it is, seems not so easy to do that, even for us devotees, to come beyond the bodily concept, completely on a pure spiritual platform, relating with another pure soul on a pure, affectionate, full-hearted, well-wishing mood. Absolutely, even when problems are there, you never... Don't cut me out of your heart, whatever I do. That is the devotee practice. That is so perfect. That's explained here, even to the enemies, the devotees have a deep, well-wishing feeling. Even you feel somebody enormously, horribly acting, but a devotee always keeps praying in the bottom of his heart with a deep well-wishing to even the worst of enemies. That is devotee life. Of course, we try to become devotees. So because that is the platform of the soul, it's such a sparky, pure platform of full life. That's important. But then again, Prabhupada said, why a soul is dear to you? Because it's a part of the super soul. So it's not the soul, it's the super soul. So you should all together, we should, don't waste your time, my friends, schoolmates, you know, don't go play here and there too much. Come on, make all your energy now to understand about the super soul, the supreme personality of God. And then you're getting the real life, you're getting the real satisfaction. That is a few times mentioned. The devotee doesn't have any worldly desires anymore. He doesn't stop desiring. Don't try to become desireless, feelingless, emotionless. That will never happen. It will backfire in another way. If you try to become without emotions, without feelings, expressions, not too high, not too low, it's going to backfire on you in one way or another. It has to be there, but what does it mean when he doesn't desire anything? He doesn't desire anything selfish anymore. Nothing. Vijnanis, they're Ashanta, right? Vijnanikani, Ashanta, but the Bhakta is Shanta. Even the Vijnanis who are so much good in self-control, discipline, but they remain restless. And the wonderful Kamakandis who follow all the rules so nice, but they remain restless. Of course, the gross materialists, they are never peaceful, absolutely, from morning to evening, always disturbed. But the devotee, he is shanti, he is completely peaceful and satisfied. Gaunishkan, he doesn't have any desire anymore. Why is, it's a special thing, why so peaceful? Because all his desires are dovetailed towards the Lord. So if you put your desires to the Lord, remember, the Lord is never alone. When the king comes, he is never alone. His queen is there, his ministers are there, servants are there. That means when the king comes, that means that. So if we say, all our energy goes to Krishna, he goes to Krishna. He goes to Radharani, he goes to all the gopis, he goes to Guru and the servants. It goes to the devotees. And you cannot separate this. If you separate them, you become really Kanishtha Adhikari. Madhyam Adhikari, he has learned to not separate Guru, Krishna and the devotees. And I think this is a big challenge still in our movement. We are working on that. How to come to this point? All this disturbance within the devotees, because we see only Krishna Guru, or your Guru, and my Guru is different, and all these things. Yeah. We should not see like this. It's all united. But because we are persons, we have different moods, we have different character, we have different way how we express, some are more outgoing, some are more introvert. And you cannot favor one for the other. If somebody is introvert, let him be introvert. If somebody is extrovert, let him be extrovert. Because you cannot, we are all individuals. We have all our own unique, specific, beautiful character. And to learn to appreciate, live with that, that requires extreme deep Krishna consciousness. And then to live in a community, that's a big challenge. But that's what Krishna consciousness will do. We will at one point create the most harmonious community life in entire humanity ever seen in Kali Yuga. We are working on that. I can see that. I want to read later on some beautiful, encouraging statements of Prabhupada. So, on an interesting point also, Prahlad makes here that for devotees also there is no need for dharma, artha, kama, moksha, saita. Generally that is, if you really want to talk about a very advanced human civilization, a solid, good civilization, there has to be these three stuff. Dharma, artha, religion, economic development, opportunity, that the senses are satisfied to some extent, because we cannot be really transcendental. And then liberation. So it's interesting. There cannot be artha, no economic development, without dharma. So now the whole West has become atheistic. It is out of the legal. This is dangerous. If you put religion out of the religious, the legal system, then you take away all the power of dharma. That's quite interesting.
I heard yesterday. it's a system of democracy where everybody has freedom of expression and everybody can doubt anything and nothing is really sure established. That is a very good system for the demons to act behind the scenes. And nobody can really get power in such a system. Only the demons. So, but religion has to have a very strong influence in the society. I can read later on one sentence of Prabhupada on this. Because we have been so trained up that religion is dangerous, religion is bad, or you get all types of fanaticism and like this. But that's because the history of religion in this Kali Yuga, it was hijacked by demons. Because there were not real pure devotees, not real the pure system of religion. So, Prabhupada says, in the Vedic system, the authority is the Vedas, which is all about dharma, religion. How to connect with God. Without God, there is no life. Without connecting, without a system of connection with God, you cannot get real life. It's all artificial dealings. It's all a puppet play of the trigunas, the relationships, well, how you act. And as devotees, we are absolutely not free of this also. We can ask ourselves how much we still act as puppets with a masquerade, and how much we are really living a real life based on the soul and the superstar. And after, we are so controlled by the last 100 years, I think this is time in history when the leaders of society have the most influence on the minds of the people. You know, they can go in every detail, especially with modern communication. So this idea of dharma and religion, it's so weak to give it power, to stand on it, to promote it, to educate it, to get really solid of it. Everybody starts shivering like this. This is the power of the demons. The Prabhupada says, in the Vedic civilization, the Vedas is the authority. And you cannot question it. My God, if you tell that today, and they say, what is this? You want to bring us again to the Inquisition time? No, it's not like this. The one who was doing the Inquisitions, they were just happy to see people seeing pain. You know? I don't know what kind of people they were. I once went to in Amsterdam to the torture museum for four.